Perfect. Well, thank you very much, Mr. President. Thank you very much to you all for being here this morning. And welcome to my presentation, which is entitled Adaptivity for Complex Flows. As usual, I will start with a very brief CV. I did my studies at the University of Delft, studying aerospace engineering. And afterwards, I went on to do a PhD in Amsterdam, which was on the subject of multi-grid solution for two fluid flows. After my PhD, I came to Constantin de Nantes in 2007, where I've worked ever since. During my time here, I have supervised or co-supervised three PhD students. Dima Valizadeh and Patrick Ploy have defended their thesis, and Sajjad Mosafari will defend early next year. I've worked with 11 master's students. I gave on average one or two lecture series per year at different institutes. Been involved in national and international projects. I've started a few informal research collaborations, been involved in organizing four conferences, and I have published a certain number of papers, conference papers, chapters, as well as two conference proceedings. Now, the subject of most of this work is my main research topic today, which is adaptive grid refinement. Grid adaptation is the technique of locally adapting a computational grid during a computation in such a way that it's perfectly adjusted for the flow that has to be calculated. Now, adaptive grid refinement is not a new technique. Classic early examples date from, let's say, the early 1980s. So why is it still interesting to study this technique today? Well, the NASA CFD Vision 2030, of which I'm very glad to have one of the authors here today, is very concerned about meshing and says, among others, that mesh generation and adaptivity continue to be significant bottlenecks in the CFD workflow. And more specifically on adaptation, adaptive mesh refinement strategies offer the potential for superior accuracy at reduced cost, but have not seen widespread use due to robustness, error estimation, and software complexity issues. So what does that mean? First of all, adaptation, at least as of 2014, was not ready yet. But also, meshing in general, mesh creation is a bottleneck, is a blocking point for modern CFD. And in my experience, from what I've seen, is that both in industry and in more physics-oriented cases, a part of this blocking is due to the need to make meshes manually. So if adaptive refinement can reduce the need to work manually, then adaptive refinement can be one of the things that can remove these blocks. I'll quickly give two examples of what I'm talking about. Typically, the industry situation is that, on one hand, very large numbers of computations are needed. Industry doesn't do one computation, they do 200 at once. But also, especially in hydrodynamic situations, the naval architect offices are very small. Typically, these are three, four people. They don't have the possibility to hire dedicated CFD specialists. Which means that both situations, given a situation where it's not easy, where they don't have the means to check if on every simulation the grid actually captures the flow features. So you may get situations like that. Automated gridding can make sure that the simulations are reliable. And then the second point is that in more fundamental flow research, we are seeing a trend towards more and more complex simulations. The reason is that certain physical aspects, such as, for example, the turbulent behavior in the core of a vortex, is just not the same for simpler flows. Now, this kind of simulation is very heavy. It stretches the limits of computational power that we have, which means that to get it right, fine cells must be placed exactly right. And if we do not know in advance where the vortices are going to be, adaptive refinement is basically the only option. But adaptive refinement for this kind of application cannot be studied on its own. It is part of a much bigger solver environment. For example, we must be sure that the adaptively refined mesh is projected onto the right geometry. Adapted meshes have to work with the discretization that's being used in the flow solver. Computational setup requires choosing parameters for the adaptation. And finally, if there's something like body motion, then the adapted mesh has to be deformed. But also, each of these elements, for me, is not important on its own. Adaptivity is not important on its own. The goal of adaptivity is to get simulation. Robust, accurate simulation for everyday use. That is the way I see flow simulation today, and that is what I work on and what I'd like to discuss with you today. So, we're going to talk about three subjects. First of all, I'm going to give you just a few elements of how to design an adaptive grid refinement method. And then I will show two applications. First of all, an application on automated simulation in a more industry-like context, and then a second, a few cases of physical flow analysis using adaptation. So first, some elements of how to design adaptive refinement. In the last 12 years, I have been making a grid adaptation method. And that means developing hundreds and hundreds of algorithms. Some small, some huge. And it's impossible here in 50 minutes to discuss all of them, and it would be very boring. But what I've seen over the years is that there are a few guiding principles which can help making the right choice for an algorithm. And some of these are the following. First of all, the need to be flexible. Because in any case, creating an adaptive grid refinement method is a huge investment in time. So it would just be a pity to make a method that only works for one type of simulation. A second point is ease of use. We're trying to help other people make better simulation. We're not helping them if it's very complicated to set up and use the adaptive grid refinement. Point is reliability also. Every time your code makes an error, every time it crashes, you lose a user, or more than one. So a lot of time is just spent debugging. And finally, you cannot allow yourself to accept limitations. You cannot say to yourself, well, this case will never happen, I will not treat it. Because 5 years later, it will happen. And that will hurt, trust me. So, and a final element is that the adaptive grid refinement has to work in a solver environment. So, the grid adaptation has to be suitable for the kind of flow solver environment that you're working in. To give an example of that, I will show you our flow solver environment. The ICCFD flow solver is developed by our team. Development was started in 1999, and it's a phase-based finite volume method that has a two-fluid capability via surface capturing method, so we can simulate water airflow. We have classical Reynolds average Navier-Stokes models, as well as more modern hybrid LES runs. we have possibility to solve 6 degrees of freedom body motion. And this body motion is taken into account for the meshing via either mesh deformation, sliding meshes, or overset meshes, of which I will show an example later on. An interesting thing for an academic code is that our code is commercialized together with Numica International. Since 2007, and today the Fine Marine computing suite is used by approximately 100 users worldwide. And what's very important for the grid adaptation is that we use the ISO-CFD flow solver together with Hexpress generated meshes. These meshes are unstructured hexahedral, and they are a combination of a body-fitted boundary mesh and an outer mesh, and this outer mesh is generated by starting with a very coarse hexahedral mesh and locally dividing these cells into finer and finer cells. Now this is important because it naturally suggests a way of adaptively refining meshes. In fact, since the original mesh was made by dividing large cells into finer cells, we can just continue this division to make a flow-adapted mesh. And one of the advantages of this is that that means that the topologies of the meshes are the same as the topologies of the meshes that we were already using. So it required virtually no changes in the flow solver to go to adaptively refined meshes. Furthermore, flexibility imposes the requirement to do unsteady flows. And unsteady flows means derefinement, means the capability to undo earlier refinements. Then, because we wanted to do derefinements, unsteady flows, and also because this cell division is finally rather cheap, it is possible to perform the mesh adaptation quite often during a simulation. It can be up to hundreds of times. But going from one requirement to another, if we want to adapt often, it means that the mesh adaptation has to be effectively parallelized so that it doesn't become a bottleneck in the whole solution. Now, these choices are not unique. These choices are even debatable. And to show you why they are not unique, I will do a quick comparison of what would happen if we would, instead of using hexahedrals, if you do refinement or adaptation of tetrahedral-based meshes. The hexahedral meshes, even though they are unstructured, they keep some kind of semi-structured character. There are large zones where the cells are all the same. And the simulations gain in accuracy due to this semi-structured character. But to keep the semi-structured character, it's mandatory to refine only by local division. Tetrahedral meshes, on the contrary, are more flexible. Because they are fully unstructured, there's no real organization in a mesh like this, which means that there's more freedom for the mesh adaptation. Notably, it's possible to adapt the orientation of the cells so that significant flow features can be followed with cells that are aligned with these features, which means that the adapted meshes can potentially be more effective. But this has to be counterbalanced by a more expensive, in general, adaptation process, where there's some potential need for more global optimization, which could theoretically lead to the choice to make fewer adaptation steps. But even this, as we've seen yesterday, is a matter of choice. However, there's one thing that tetrahedral and hexahedral mesh refinement can have in common, and that is the refinement criterion. The refinement criterion that is the part of the algorithm which indicates where the mesh should be refined. which cells should be made finer or should be made coarser. And the principle I've been using comes from tetrahedral mesh refinement. And it's the principle of metric-based refinement. Now, the idea of metric refinement is that the refinement criterion is going to be a tensor field defined over the whole flow domain. And this tensor is used to take the dimensions of the cell, which in a hexahedral context is the distance between the two opposing faces in all directions. These dimensions are modified by multiplying with the metric tensor. And then, as a second step, adaptive refinement is applied so that these modified lengths become all the same, so that under the effect of the metric transformation, the mesh is uniform. Now, because these tensors can be anisotropic, can be different, the result is that the actual mesh is as locally refined. And the beauty of this idea is that this metric procedure, basically the only thing that it does in the adaptive context is define a length scale. So that's why this method can be used for tetrahedral refinement, where the length scale is typically an edge length, but it could be transplanted directly into a hexahedral refinement context. Now, a few quick words on some works that I've done for these metric tensors. First of all, some work, a particular difficulty is computing the Hessians of the flow, which are second derivative based, on this kind of locally refined mesh where you have finer cells laying next to coarser cells. Because what happens in this kind of situations is that there are some small wiggles which appear in the pressure. Now, a small wiggle in the pressure leads to huge wiggles in its second derivatives. So the way that we are currently computing these second derivatives is by evaluating the first derivative first, then applying some smoothing to get rid of the medium wiggles that appear in the gradients, and then deriving the gradients once again to get to the Hessian. And a second development is typical for free surface flows, which is make a refinement criterion which refines at the position of the free surface. I'm sorry, it's kind of hard to see in this image, but this can be done with a metric tensor which has only one non-zero eigenvalue, associated with an eigenvector normal to the direction of the surface, which will give you refinement only in the direction normal of the surface. And we've also combined this free surface criterion with criterion based on Hessians of the flow to get a criterion that can adapt the mesh everywhere for free surface flows. So going from this metric-based refinement, which I think is a great example of designing for flexibility, to how to work with ease of use. And ease of use depends on, among others, on the user guidelines for the adaptive refinement. Now, especially in industry, you cannot say to an industry partner, well, try a few different settings and see what works. They don't have the time for that. So you need to be able to say you take these and these and these parameters and your computation will run fine the first time. And for me, a great way of testing user guidelines is to make computer scripts that do the setup. Because if Python can do a whole computation, so can anyone. And this illustration here, this is the first time that we actually did a full simulation without any user intervention based on computer scripts. But this was free surface only refinement. And matters become a little bit more complicated when you try to script Hessian criteria, because then it's going to be needed to calculate the threshold which is the global parameter which indicates how fine the mesh should be. And there's no direct relation between this threshold and the resulting mesh. So not so easy to choose. My first idea for this was, would it be possible to give recommendations for the threshold based on classes of simulations? Let's say four slender ships at certain orientations. So the first thing to do was it would make sense to make a refinement criterion that is non-dimensional, such that at the very least, the refinement criterion and the recommendations would not depend on the size of the ship nor on its speed. So once I decided to do that, on the equivalent of a rainy Wednesday afternoon, I went over my entire back catalog of simulations that I had done with Hessian criteria. And it was just everything, like wings, ships, 2D, 3D, everything combined. First of all, for all these simulations, I computed the equivalent threshold if the criterion had been non-dimensional. Then the second thing I did was mentally class these meshes into coarse, medium, and fine. And then, finally, I plotted the results, which was, at least for me, a huge surprise. There is a trend. Somehow, all medium to fine meshes end up with thresholds that are about 1/10 of the reference length. All fine meshes, really fine meshes, are typically twice smaller thresholds, and coarser meshes around the 0.2 mark. Well, this is not hard science, but I think it's a nice illustration of showing how some physical insight through non-dimensionalization combined with just plain old engineering experience can lead to usable user guidelines. So, to end the discussion on mesh refinement principles, I'd like to tell you a story. And I'd like to tell you a story about what not to do in terms of accepting limitations. And this story is about directional derefinement. Derefinement means undoing earlier refinements. And to do that, you need to store the history of the refinement, at least in a hexagonal context. Many people do this history storage in a kind of octree structure. But since I'm thinking about an anisotropic context where not cells are not always divided in eight, it made more sense to use a simpler history structure where just every cell gets 1 point, every refined cell of a group gets 1 point or two, another cell of the group, and they all get 1 point or two the original cell from which they were formed. Now this choice does impose limitations. For refinement, there's no limitation. You can go from one cell to a cell refined in all directions, and you can go from one cell to a cell refined in only one direction. However, there is a limitation for derefinement. If a cell was divided in four, I can go from four to one. However, I have no means of going from a cell refined in four to a cell refined in two. Now, when I decided this, I was thinking, first of all, that anyway derefinement was less important than refinement. So it wasn't a big deal. Second thing I was thinking about was that with the dynamic mesh adaptation, this would sort itself out. And I was completely wrong. Because I can show you what happens with this very simple test case. This is a cut through a ship, and what I wanted to do here is to make a mesh adapted to the free surface, but the free surface at rest, so without waves at all. So a proper anisotropically refined mesh would look something like this. However, when I tried this, the resulting mesh I got was this, which is a mess. What's happening here? Well, this mesh here is much too coarse to resolve the free surface. So the refinement criterion computed from the free service is going to be all over the place. And it's going to impose refinement in both directions. However, when the mesh is nicely converged, this horizontal refinement can go away, it's no longer needed. But the vertical refinement has to remain to capture the surface. And since the two are linked, this one can't go away. Well, I resolved this problem finally by doing the way the Soviets modified their official history photos. I changed the refinement history after the fact. What I did was when I wanted to go from a cell divided in four to a cell divided in two, I talked to this cell and I say, hey cell, you are not divided in four. You are divided in two. And then you were divided, these two cells were divided in two again, in the direction which you disappear. And once a cell believes that, the original derefinement procedure will happily go from here to here. But that's not enough. Because to do this trick, I need to have cells that are refined in all directions at once. So after each refinement step, I go once again over the entire mesh, looking for cells that are divided in two and then in two again. And I say to these cells, no, you were not divided in two and in two, you were divided in four. And the same way, cells divided in four and then in two become cells in two and then in four. Which means that the refinement history is going to be a complete lie. But hey, it works. Well, don't get me wrong, I spend a lot of time on this procedure and I'm proud of it. But if I had thought about these limitations before, this frankly complicated procedure would not have been needed. Let's switch topics and have a look at how adaptive refinement can help in streamlining automated simulation. And the case of automated simulation that I want to talk about is automatic shape adaptation, which we studied first in the context of the PhD thesis of Patrick Plouet. And this was shape optimization of lifting hydrofoils. Hydrofoils are currently being used on sailing ships to lift the entire boat out of the water so that it flies over the water, supported only on the hydrofoils, which means that speeds can be attained that have been never possible before. From a simulation standpoint, however, a hydrofoil is not simple, because the difficulty with a hydrofoil is that it can have very different immersion depths. The foil can fly with its tip almost sticking out of the water, and it can also be completely underwater. If you want to be able to treat all these cases, then either you can fill your entire mesh with fine cells, or you resort to adaptive refinement to capture the free surface. Now, these simulations were used in metamodel-based adaptation, or metamodel-based optimization. So we studied a design space of three parameters. For the foil, the angle of the tip could be varied. In the same way, the twist of the tip was varied. And finally, the immersion depth was adjusted in order to find the combination that had the least drag. So for a couple of combinations, the flows were simulated, and then an interpolated response surface was fitted through these points. And the optimum was found from this response surface. And then in a greedy algorithm, the response surface was refined by adding simulations where this would be most useful. Of course, the whole loop is automated, so this required fully automated simulation. And the extremes of the design space are quite far apart. Like you can see here, the four corners of the design space with different immersion depths and different angles for the foil geometry. So The pictures show the pressure and it shows the spray. You can see that these are very, very different. And kind of unpredictable. So we were quite glad to have adaptive refinement to take care of the free surface. Then this project, it led to another optimization work, which is a collaboration with CNR INM in Rome, Italy. Here the focus shape changed from hydrofoils to ships. The refinement became combined free surface and Hessian based. And the meter models became multi-fidelity. What does that mean? To gain time, most of the meter model is going to be based on these black triangles, which are inaccurate but inexpensive simulations. And then in only a few points of the design space, accurate simulations are going to be performed in order to find a global correction of these inaccurate simulations. In the hope of getting the accuracy of the accurate simulations combined with the cost of the inaccurate ones. Now, we talked about this at a conference, and we found that means this situation, it means that there is a need for fully automatic creation of computations with different accuracy levels. We talked about this, and I said, hey, I can do this using adaptive refinement. This, by the way, is the Italian way of expressing low and high fidelity. But the principle is that in the metric-based context, you have that the modified cell sizes are equal to this global threshold. So if the refinement criterion is the same between two simulations, then the cell sizes everywhere are going to be proportional to this threshold value. Which means that if you take a certain threshold value and you make it, let's say, four times smaller, you get a mesh that's four times finer everywhere. So using this, it's just easy to incorporate in an automatic procedure the use of two or even more than two different fidelities. To finish the discussion on more industrial type applications, I wanted to show this one, which is not really related to automated simulation, but it's very important in an industrial context, and that is the use of overset meshing. Overset meshing is needed when you have a body which has to make quite strong movements. And then what you can do to follow these movements is to make a small mesh designed here in blue, around the object, and this small mesh is going to move through a much larger red background mesh. And the connection between the two meshes is made by a dynamic interpolation. Now, with this interpolation is adjusted all the time to account for the movements. Now, this interpolation only works well if the cell sizes on the two sides of the interface are the same. So in order to get that, you have two choices. Either you fill your entire background mesh with very fine cells, or if you have a normal computer like everyone, then you use adaptive refinement. Because the adaptive refinement can be used to make sure that the meshes are actually the same size on both sides. And the way I did that was defining a metric in an inverse manner. Instead of defining cell sizes from the metric, I compute the metric from the current cell sizes. And then this metric is exchanged between the two domains and used to adapt the cell in the other domain. And then with this capability, we can do this kind of simulation, which is a ship in waves, where the waves are treated with adaptive refinement. The overset coupling uses adaptive refinement. The turning propellers are meshed with sliding meshes. And then the turning rudders here are also overset meshes with adaptive refinement if needed. And the total simulation looks like this. You can see how the ship moves in waves. You can see on the propellers how the pressure is changing as the ship moves in waves. Because when it's climbing a wave, there's more pressure than when it's going down. And if you look very carefully, you can see that the rudders move to keep the ship on its course. Here they are to one side, and you'll see later on that they move to the other side. So now, to finish the presentation, I would like to look at two situations where we have used adaptive refinement for physical analysis. And the first one was a project that was done with two master's students, Timothée Lebouleu and Morand Charloux. And it concerns the simulation of ventilated flows. Ventilation is the situation where air is sucked under the water surface on something like a rudder, a propeller, or a hydrofoil. And ventilation is, first of all, a dangerous phenomenon because it can lead to an almost total loss of lift in something like seconds. And furthermore, it's difficult to simulate. One of the reasons, one of the difficulties that we found when looking through the experimental literature is what you can see here, which is the existence of bistable states in the same combination of angle of attack and speed. A hydrofoil can both have a stable non-ventilating flow and a stable ventilating flow, which means that if nature sends your flow into one of these stable states, you can just be sure that your simulation ends up in the other one. Now, to know more about this, among others, we looked at the transition, the natural transition from wetted to ventilated flow. And we found that this was highly dependent not only on the actual state, but on the motion history of the foil. For example, if you take a hydrofoil that's at a fixed angle of attack and you accelerate it from rest, you get a transition that looks something like this. At the leading edge of the foil, the surface breaks open. There's a pocket that grows from the top to the bottom, and it becomes fully ventilated. On the other hand, if you keep the foil at a fixed velocity and you increase its angle of attack, the transition mechanism looks like this. Now it's not the leading edge, but it's at the trailing edge, at the bottom, that the bubble breaks open and that the flow becomes ventilated. So the meshes that we were using here were not enormous. It's like the order of 4 to 8 million cells. But going from wetted to ventilated flow, the topology changes are huge. So it was really a really reassuring thought to know that adaptive refinement took care of this topology change and made sure that the mesh was always in the right place. And then the last case I want to show you is related to the PhD work of Sajjad Mozaffari. And it concerns adaptive refinement for hybrid ADS simulation. Over the last few years in our group, we have seen more and more situations where classical Rance turbulence modeling is not sufficient to capture the physics of the flow. For example, this is research published in 2018, performed by Emmanuel Guimino, Ginevra Rubino, and Michel Visionneau. And they studied a ship with a bulb on the front in a sideslip condition. So the ship is not only going forward, it's going sideways also. That leads to the creation of a tip vortex-like structure behind the bulb. And the big question in this research was to get the right amount of turbulence in the core of this vortex, which in experiments was rather high. Now, the Rand simulation gives us the classical view of a vortex, which is an elongating turning structure, which is more or less laminar in its core. And the amount of turbulence in this situation was way too low. However, going to hybrid LES simulations gives a completely different picture of the flow. In that case, we see that it looks like this. What looks like one vortex is actually a complete combination of hundreds and hundreds of ring-like vortex structures, which are very dynamic, so which create a lot of turbulence kinetic energy in the core. Now, a difficulty for this work was to get fine meshes that follow the vortex core. So what we tried to do in the PhD top work of Sajjad was to see if we could simulate this kind of flow on adaptively refined meshes. Now, that is not so easy, because one of the problems with hybrid LES simulations is that a part of the turbulence is resolved, and the amount of turbulence that can be resolved depends on the mesh. So if you have your situation like here, where a fine mesh is located next to a mesh that's twice coarser, and the turbulence goes from here to here, you're going to lose half of it, just because it cannot be resolved on this coarser mesh. And it's hybrid LES, so there is a modeled turbulence part, and that's going to react to this change. But it's not going to compensate everything, and the compensation is not immediate. So for this kind of simulation, changes in mesh size are a problem. And by extension, changing the mesh in time through adaptive refinement is also a problem. Now, we talked about this with, among others, with Eric Lamballet, who works in Poitiers. And his suggestion was, but you have this nice adaptive grid refinement method. Why don't you use it in such a way that in the main flow structures, the mesh does not change? Why don't you use it to make a mesh that's uniform around the region which really interests you? But that means using adaptation in some kind of an average-based sense. So Sajjad studied a lot of questions about this, and one of them is, how do you make an average refinement criterion? Are you going to compute a Hessian criterion from the averaged flow, or do you compute the criterion from the instantaneous flow and then average the criterion? Well, the first problem with basing criterion on the average solution is that the average solution is interpolated between refined meshes. And this interpolation, at least the way we used it, is not C2, which makes it impossible to compute good Hessians from it. But more fundamentally, you're not actually simulating the average flow. You are simulating the instantaneous flow all the time. So it would make more sense to make meshes that are adapted to the instantaneous flow in an average sense. So this is the choice that we finally settled for. And this, in the end of the project, allowed us to do the full simulation of the ship inside flow condition, inside slip condition. Where you can see that if you don't look at the average flow structure, but at the instantaneous one, that the flow actually looks like this. And you have to imagine that all of these small vortex details are resolved on at least 4 cells, which gives an impression of the density of this mesh. It had 150 million cells, which is, by the way, it's the largest adapted mesh that we've done so far. And it's, I think, surprisingly smooth. The mesh is quite regular. And if you look in the main vortex core, the cell sizes here are everywhere equal to the minimum cell size that we specified. And going finally to the analysis of the terminus kinetic energy, we made a plot of the amount of terminus kinetic energy in the very core of this vortex. And if you look at the black line, which is the experimental results, you can see that the Reynolds-Navier-Stokes situation, this is a log plot, so it's at least an order of magnitude too low. However, the both hybrid Rans-LES simulations are at more or less the right level. They overestimate a little bit. And the final conclusion is that the red line, which was the original simulation, it shows very good agreement until the end of the vortex, where the terminus kinetic energy is dropping off, because in that position, the meshes were not that fine anymore. However, adaptive refinement is capable of keeping the mesh fine until the end. So we get the right tendency for the terminus kinetic energy up to the back of this ship. And the main conclusion we got from this work is that even for this kind of complicated simulation, adaptive refinement is becoming operational. Now, I've come to the end of my presentation. And before actually concluding, I want to say that you see me talking here, but this is not the work of one person. First of all, I want to thank the METRIC team, our group, for allowing me to join you and for sharing your work with us all together, so that together we can achieve things that would be impossible for every one of us on our own. I want to thank Alexander Hay, who in his 2004 PhD thesis in our group laid the basis for adaptive refinement. PhD students supervised by me and by others made contributions, some of which I've shown you here in this presentation. Master's students have worked on everything, going from criteria, user guidelines, testing, physical applications. I want to thank international colleagues for collaboration. Numica have been very important, first of all in having the courage to actually market adaptive grid refinement to their users, and second in providing constant comments, requests, suggestions, which have made the current adaptive grid refinement method a lot better. And finally, thanks to FineMarine users worldwide who used the method and who gave feedback. I would not be standing here without all of you. Let's conclude. From what I've shown you today, the current status of the work is that the solver with refinement, then the solution environment with adaptive grid refinement, is becoming operational. I've shown that it is possible to do automated series of computations. It's becoming a logical choice for heavy-duty physical analysis simulations. On a short to medium-term perspective, the things I would like to do, well, first of all, the main remaining bottleneck is the treatment of geometry and the projection of the mesh on the geometry. And I know I'm not the only one to say that. Something I would like to do is to go to more larger simulations to make sure that the code is really optimized for this kind of orders of magnitude. And then applications. Now that we have an adaptation method like that, there's so many nice things we could do with it. But on a little bit longer time scale, I titled my presentation Adaptivity for Complex Flows. And yet, the only adaptation I've talked about for the moment is mesh adaptation. But the same principle could be can and is applied elsewhere. The discretization can be adapted through P-refinement or combined HP. Turbulence models. Detached eddy simulation is already, in a way, an adaptive turbulence model because it changes from rounds to LES based on the size of the mesh. But I think this can be pushed further. Simulation setup, there are ways to, it's good to think about ways to automate the choice of parameters. And even in something like a meta-model optimization framework, the very choice of the points to simulate is adaptive. So the principle is the same everywhere. Once we understand completely how a choice works, we can write an algorithm so that the throw solver can make the choice and remove the burden from the user to make these choices. This is how I see the flow solver of the future. And this is the type of research that I would like to contribute to. Thank you very much for your attention.